Ten Commandments of Jesus Christ, Part 8. Ten Commandments of Jesus Christ, Part 8. John 14:15. If you love me, keep my commandments. 14:21. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. John 15:10. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love. We should know his commandments. We should love his commandments. We should keep his commandments. We should abide in his commandments. There are people who say that we are not under commandments. We are under grace. Jesus says, if you keep my commandments, you love me. If you have my commandments, and if you abide in my commandments, I will abide in you. So we should know his commandments, we should love his commandments, we should have his commandments, we should keep his commandments, we should abide his commandments. God gave his commandments through Moses. And Jesus, greater than Moses, he gave his commandments himself. And when we violate, when we break the commandments of Moses in the Old Testament, if they could be stoned, if they could be punished, the Bible says what a greater punishment it would be when we break the commandments which Jesus has given. What a greater condemnation. So the commandments of Jesus Christ that we read in Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, and also in the teachings of the apostles, what they learned from Jesus, they taught the church. We should keep the commandments. So to study all the commandments of Jesus Christ in a very concise way, I have taken 10 commandments. When we meditate on these 10 commandments, along with we meditate a number of other allied commandments. But I don't say that we cover all the commandments in totality. It's only just a foretaste. How we should abide by his commandments. How we should live in his commandments. So the 10 commandments. I'm just taking 10 of Jesus' commandments and many other allied commandments. Number one, Jesus said, receive the Holy Ghost. No, I got the Holy Ghost. Even I was born in the Holy Ghost. Now Jesus said, receive the Holy Ghost. Now I'm doing ministry. Jesus said, receive the Holy Ghost. When you don't receive the Holy Ghost, you are violating Jesus' commandment. You are not keeping up Jesus' commandment. If you love Jesus, you'll keep Jesus' commandments. If you keep Jesus' commandments, you love him. And you don't receive the Holy Spirit and say, I love Jesus, but I don't want to receive the Holy Spirit. It's a deception. Jesus said, receive the Holy Ghost. Repent, believe, be baptized, and receive the Holy Ghost. All Jesus' commandments. Repent. From your thoughts, from your ways. Repent unto the word of God. Turn unto the word of God. Believe Jesus is God manifested in flesh. Believe He is a rewarder of them who seek Him diligently. Be baptized into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that you can have a newness of life. So repent, believe, and be baptized. You shall receive the Holy Ghost. When you receive the Holy Ghost, the second commandment we meditated, take up your cross and follow Him. Follow Him means imitate Him. Go in the same way with Him. Go in the same way with Him. So follow His footstep. He has set us an example. He has become our ensample. In different situations we know what we should do. Imitate Him. We have got a rolling model. So follow Him. Number three, He said, when you follow Me, seek ye God's kingdom and His righteousness. What's the kingdom of God? It's not eating and drinking. It's not a festival. Christianity is not Easter, Good Friday, Christmas, etc., etc. Christianity is not eating and drinking, not with a set of festivals, like in any other religion. They have to keep up that festival. They have to keep up that fast. They cannot be a good religious person of that sect if he doesn't follow that fast. If he's a religious person, how do we know that he is a religious person? He follows those festivals, those fasts. But Christianity, the kingdom of God, is not eating and drinking, it's not a set of festivals. It is righteousness, peace, and the joy of the Holy Ghost. What is righteousness? A life pleasing to God by living to His standard. A life pleasing to God by living to His standard. Peace. A life living with no anxiety, no worry, fullness of rest, well settled and secured assurance. A life with a secured assurance in Him. Now what's the joy of the Holy Ghost? A life that is carefree and delightful. Seek that. That's His kingdom principle. So receive the Holy Spirit, begin to imitate Him, then seek a life that is pleasing to His standard, a life free from all worries, a life full of cheers and delights. Seek that. It's not a life with fighting. It's not a life with worries. If at all we can be sorrowful, we have to be sorrowful because of the perishing souls. There's nothing else that we could really worry about. And number four, okay, you receive the Holy Spirit, you begin to follow Him, you are seeking His kingdom principles. Be perfect. Be perfect. Be perfect in the will of God. Be perfect in your understanding. Be perfect in love. Be perfect man. A perfect man, what does it actually mean? If you are a student, be that perfect student. If you are a husband, be that perfect husband. If you are a wife, be that perfect wife. That perfection. Perfection is not completion. Philosophically, perfection means nothing more wanting. Nothing more wanting. As a wife, you're perfect. Nothing more wanting. Nothing more wanting. As a husband, you are perfect. Nothing more wanting. Nothing more wanting. There can be a better husband. That's all. What all we expect from a husband. Or rather, what the Bible says the husband should be. You are perfect. You are perfect. It's in the mindset. Thus minded. Thus minded. If you are a student, be perfect. Finish your homework perfectly well. What are the assignments given? Do it perfectly well. Keep up your timing perfectly well. Do your best. You are perfect. You are a perfect student. A perfect student. From toe to head. Is a school uniform? You must have shoes? Yes, I've got shoes. That should be well polished. A blanket? Yes, it's done. Proper uniform? Yes. Hairstyle? Yes. Books? Yes. Homework? Yes. In every area. That's not at all difficult. It is possible. It is possible. A perfect husband. A perfect wife. A perfect student. A perfect employer. A perfect employee. Try to be perfect. My dear brother, my dear sister. That should be the mindset. Jesus said, be perfect. Be perfect. And number five. To do this in remembrance of me. This do ye. He talked about the participating the Lord's Supper. We call that the Lord's Supper, Lost Supper, Eucharist, Holy Communion, etc. This do. Do that regularly. In remembrance of God. In remembrance of God. So when you participate in the Lord's Supper, you saw the Lord's death, you see the Lord's coming, that's the time that you search yourself to be found. So show the Lord's death, see the Lord's coming, search yourself in His light. Search yourself in His light. Participate worthily. There it is, an adverb that describes your action of participation. That's not an adjective. That doesn't describe the quality of the person who participates. Nobody can say that I am worthy to participate, not the quality. But your action, your mindset, how you participate in it, that should be in a worthy way. How should you participate in it? Number one, prove that you are a believer. Prove that your sins are forgiven. Prove that you believe Jesus. So participate as a worthy person. Participate regularly. That shows what's the reverence you have got for this. Your discipline. The table of the Lord should not become contemptible. Kathodiya pandi ennamattu poga kudadu, arpama nenaikka kudadu. So participate regularly. And when you participate, participate reverentially. You are remembering the death of Christ. The bread that we bless. For you to have the fellowship with the body of Christ. The cup that we bless, for you to have the fellowship with the blood of Jesus Christ. So reverentially participate. It's more than who you are, it is how you participate. So prove that you are a child of God. Prove, participate regularly, participate reverentially, and participate with an introspection. You're already clean. But this is a wonderful opportunity for you to examine yourself. Anything that could displease, anything that's not pleasing God, confess it. We all are clean, but our hands, our feet, in our life, there's an argument, pride, maybe a lie, maybe the temptation of eyes, speaking some words which are not Christian. Now cleanse yourself, search yourself in the light of the Lord. Don't justify. At times you can't stop crows flying over your head, but you can stop them building its nest on your head. Don't justify your wrongs. Search yourself, introspect yourself, and participate. Number five, enjoy total peace. Peace with God, peace with others, and peace within. Peace with God, peace with others, peace within. Participate. Last week, we saw number six. Go. Go. Make all disciples. Make all those who could follow the teachings of Jesus Christ. Baptize them. Baptize them. Teach them all things whatsoever He has commanded us. So it's not only the duty of the pastors, it's not only the duty of a Bible teacher. When you make others disciples, followers, when you make others followers of Jesus Christ, students of Jesus Christ, what do you mean by students of Jesus Christ? Those allowed to be taught on the principles of Jesus Christ. So when they enroll themselves to learn the teachings of Jesus Christ, whatever Jesus Christ has commanded, you teach them. Jesus said, repent. Jesus said, take up your cross and follow Him. Jesus said, believe and be baptized. Jesus said that you should receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus said that we should follow Him. Jesus said that we should participate in the Lord's Supper regularly. Jesus said, teach whatever I have commanded you. Whatever I have commanded you. So we had a very quick recapitulation of what we have studied in the last few weeks, six commandments and many other allied commandments with these six basic commandments. Or rather, the seventh one, beware. Beware, beware, Jesus again and again said, beware. And already I have preached a message on beware and 11 points that we should be very careful. And you can collect that message and listen to it. Not 11, 12 points where we have to be very careful. Beware. We have to be very careful about those things. And we consider, how could we be careful? How could we be careful? So five things I gave you. Number one, whatever that instruction, especially when the Lord says beware, be careful. Take it to heed. Take it to heed. Mind the gap. Mind your language. Mind what you are doing. To be careful, the first thing, take it to the mind. Listen seriously. Not listening through ear, but listening through mind. Take it to the mind. Number two, when you take it to the mind, chew it. Give a thought to it. Mummy said like this. Daddy said like this. My teacher said like this. My pastor said like this. What is that? Give a thought to it. Give a thought to it. Number three, think about consequences of trespass. If I don't obey, what will happen? If I do as I want, what will happen? What will happen? Even as a child, whatever the commandment, especially the commandment of Jesus Christ, take it to the mind. Think about it seriously. Think about the consequence you would face otherwise. Think about the consequence you would face otherwise. And number four, take a firm decision. Yes, I do what my mother says. No, I will not do what my mother says. Whatever the decision you take, you'll eat the fruit thereof. If your decision is right, you'll get the blessing of that. If your decision is wrong, you'll get the punishment of that. If the decision is right, you'll get the reward of that. If the decision is wrong, you'll get the punishment of that. You can't escape. There is no demilitarized zone. No punishment, no reward, no nothing like that. So take the right decision. And when you take the right decision, try to execute that decision. Execute that decision. That is being beware. Being beware. Today, very important one. The eighth one we are going to see. The eighth one we are going to see. It's very, very important. If you've got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. We shall read verse 44. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Here we see there are four commandments. But I say unto you, love your enemies. I say unto you, bless them that curse you. I say unto you, do good to them that hate you. I say unto you, pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. In these four commandments, I take one, bless them that curse you. Bless them that curse you. Jesus' teachings are not very difficult. But it seems to be apparently a very difficult one. Somebody is cursing us. How to bless them? But Jesus says, I say unto you, bless them that hate you. In Luke chapter 6 verse 28, Luke also records that, bless them that curse you. Romans 12:14, Paul says, bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Bless them that persecute you. Bless and curse not. 1 Corinthians 4:12. And labor, working with our own hands, being reviled, we bless. They learnt it. Being reviled, we bless. Being persecuted, we suffer it. We accept it. Being persecuted, we suffer it. Peter says, 1 Peter 3:9, not rendering evil for evil, not rendering evil for evil, or railing for railing, but contrarywise, blessing. When railing, bless them. For evil, bless them. Not evil for evil. Not railing for railing. Contrarywise, blessing. Knowing that you are there unto called, that you should inherit a blessing. You know that you are called to inherit a blessing. Knowing that you are called to inherit a blessing, bless them. You'll inherit a blessing. So Jesus said, bless them that curse you. Paul says, bless them that persecute you. And again Paul says, we bless people, those who curse us. Peter says, when they do evil to you, don't do evil. When they revile at you, don't revile back. Bless them. Knowing that you are called to inherit blessing, bless them. So when we are cursed, when we are persecuted, when we are reviled at, when they speak all manner of evil things against us, how to bless them? My dear brother, my dear sister, I'm not just giving a sermon. I'm just telling how we can live Christians. It's not playing Christians. We don't play the role of a Christian. The other day in the drama, Simon played the role of Paul. Many a time we play the role of Christians. We act like Christians. We love to smile like Christians. We play the role of Christians. No, no, don't play the role of Christians. Live the life of Christians. Live the life of Christians. It's not forgiving somebody. It's not when somebody is throwing stones at us, oh God, forgive them. That's a drama. That's a drama. But literally when people are throwing stones, words at you, praying for their forgiveness, praying for their blessing, and blessing them, that is life. So are we playing Christians or are we living Christians? Paul was not playing Christian. He was not playing the role of a Christian. Paul was not a disciple of Jesus Christ. Paul was never an apostle of Jesus Christ in the days of Jesus. But he has learned it. I bless those who persecute me. He learned that lesson. It became his life. Yesterday I was waiting in the presence of the Lord. The Lord taught me, I can say the Lord taught me, I gave a very deep thought to it, 5 things how we can bless people, those who curse us. Please listen carefully. How we can, the Lord taught me how we can bless people who really curse us. Number one, when somebody persecutes us, somebody hurts us, somebody speak all manner of evil things against us, somebody revile at us, somebody speaks lie on us, the first thing is bitterness. Our reaction is based on that bitterness. Either we can hit them back, we can spit on their face, or we can go out and speak bad about them, or at least we can pray that God should kill them. Or we pray that God should punish them. That's a natural reaction of that bitterness. The sorrow, hurt, everything, if I can bring in one word, bitter. So, first thing for you to bless somebody who curses you, you have to remove that bitterness. Bitterness is a natural reaction. Just imagine a brother and sister, akka thambi. There's a small quarrel, akka thangachi, both the sisters, a small quarrel. Akka is shouting at the thangachi for something. Thangachi is very upset. Akka is shouting and going out. In a hurry, she bangs on the door. In a hurry, she bangs on the door. Immediately, what the thangachi says, venu venu. Swami adishtaru. So we are very happy that Swami adishtaru. Somebody who shouted at us, somebody who reviled us, nam yaro thittanga, nam yaro nammala vedana paduthinaanga, avangalukku or adi vilundichina namakku romba sandosham. It's with the husband and wife. It's with the husband and wife. If something happened to him, the first word she would say, "Ninga enna pesuningalle adukku venum." Venum, venum. So somewhere there is a joy when that person suffers. That's an ordinary reaction. I just show you a few verses. In Genesis 27:34, when Esau heard the words of Jacob, that his brother came and stole away the blessings, that the Bible says, Esau, probably 70 years old at that time, he was married and they got children. Not a small boy. Esau must be at a time at least 70 years old. When Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry. Somebody has, his own brother has taken away his blessings. Anna is unable, not even Anna and brother, they are co-bonds. They are twins. They are twins. Maybe by a few seconds, Esau must have come out first. But biologically, one who comes second was conceived first. All seconds difference, or a fraction of a second difference. They are the same age. His brother, his twin brother has taken that blessing. He could not bear it. He could not bear it. He thought it was a right for him. He thought he was the eldest son. He should have that, the right birthright. He was an eldest son just by a few seconds. Just by a few seconds. But he wanted to have the birthright. He wanted to have his father's blessings on him. When he knew that his brother has taken it, born with him, a 70-year-old man crying with a bitter cry. From that moment, he wanted to kill his brother. So we read about the Israelites in the land of Egypt. Exodus chapter 1 verse 14. The Egyptians made their lives bitter with hard bondage. When we see that our freedom is curtailed, we become bitter. We become bitter. The life of Hannah, the other woman, she was always teasing her, and she didn't have a child. Her womb was shut. She was bitter. There's one powerful verse in Psalm 64 verse 4. Psalm 64 verse 4. That they may shoot in secret at the perfect. They shoot in secret at the perfect. Suddenly do they shoot at him and fear not. They shoot at the perfect. Suddenly they shoot at the perfect. They fear not. With what they shoot at the perfect, in verse 3, who wet their tongue like a sword, and bend their bows to shoot their arrows, even bitter words. Bitter words. Like arrows. The husband is not hesitating to speak all manner of evil words against his wife. At times she may be perfect. Here we read in verse 24, that they may shoot in secret at the perfect words. At times the wife will shoot arrows, pierce the liver of the husband, heart rent. The wife will speak all manner of evil words, bitter words. Nee poriki, nee useless, nee udari, nee laikilla. His heart will be broken, ruthlessly. He is perfect. He is a good Christian. He is a child of God. She shoots at arrow. Bitter word. His heart became broken. I can go on and on and on. Our life becomes bitter because of so many reasons. The teacher, to correct the child, she uses a harsh word. My dear brother, my dear sister, the child commits suicide. Bitter. She could not bear it. The father says, you are useless. The son runs away from the house. But as mature Christians, we must know to handle our bitterness. What happened to Isa? That will happen to us. In your office, in your family, somebody will usurp your rights. Your life will become bitter. That will happen in your office. That may happen in your business. Or you may be a realtor. And you labored so much in your real estate business, and somebody has swept away with a booty. Your own brother must have taken away that booty. Your own friend, your own partner must have taken away that booty. How bitter your life would be. But as a Christian, we must know how to handle that bitterness. I'll show you, because I want to tell you five things how we can bless them that curse us. But I handle this handling bitterness first. Handling bitterness. Remove bitterness from your life. Then only you can bless them that curse you. So only this first part I handle elaborately, and the other four things I will do mention to you. In Hebrews chapter 12, please make a note of it. From verse 12 I read, "Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down, and the feeble knees." Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down, and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, and feet that which is lame be turned out of the way. That is, I'll put it in simple, ordinary nundi. Nundi nundi nadakkuram. Mottama kaal pesagada padiki, Tamil la irukku. Nundi anavanukku kaal pesagada padiki. நடக்கிறதே நொண்டி நொண்டி நடந்துகிட்டு இருக்கும். அந்த காலம் பெசகிடுச்சுன்னா. ஸோ இன் இங்கிலீஷ் ப்ராபர்லி ஐ நோ ஹவு மச் வீ கேன் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட். அண்ட் மேக் ஸ்ட்ரெயிட் பாத்ஸ் ஃபார் யுவர் ஃபீட். ஸ்மூத்தாக நட. எப்படியா? தேட் விச் இஸ் லேம் பி டேர்ன்ட் அவுட் ஆஃப் த வே. ஆல்ரெடி இட் இஸ் லேம். அது பொசிஷன் விட்டு விலகிடக்கூடாது, முட்டு விலகிடக்கூடாது, பிசைகிடக்கூடாது. என்ன ஆகிறதுங்க, நொண்டிக்கு முட்டி பிசைகிடுச்சுன்னா. அதனால் ஒழுங்காக நடக்கிறதுக்கு என்ன பண்ணணுமா? பட் லெட் இட் பி ரேதர் பி ஹீல்டு. ஃபாலோ பீஸ் வித் ஆல் மென் ஃபார் தேட். ஃபாலோ பீஸ் வித் ஆல் மென் அண்ட் ஹோலினஸ், விதவுட் விச் நோ மேன் ஷல் சீ த லார்ட். லுக்கிங் டெலிஜென்ட்லி lest any man fall of the grace of God. Don't fall of the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Don't allow any bitterness to trouble you. If bitterness troubles you, what will happen? Nondi ki kaal pesagana mari aayidum. Already nondi. You should allow that to be healed. In time, it's beautiful. But let it rather be healed. And the hurt, heal ahavide. I think that it would be easier for me to put it in Tamil. It's easier for you to understand that in Tamil. Yedho or hurt, aga nondi nondi nadakkara. Nondi nondi nadandhu kaal pesagiren. Bitter arundhana kaalum pesagi poidum. Allow that to be healed. Again, na panne, remove that bitterness. Follow peace with all men. Remove that bitterness from your heart. Remove that bitterness. Looking diligently, lest any man fall of the grace of God. If you continue to harbor that bitterness, you will fall from the grace of God. Lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble of you. The bitterness is the root, but that springs up. That the hatred, vanishing, shouting, the simplest thing, as I said, venu venu, nalla venu, Sami adichare. This is the shoot of that root. This is the shoot of that root. And there may many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator, a profane person, as is, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. So he compares these with that. So don't allow that bitterness. And in James chapter 3, from verse 13, James chapter 3, verse 13, who is a wise man and endued with knowledge, among you? Who is the wise man endued with knowledge? Are you wise men? Are you wise woman? Wise wife? Wise husband? Wise parent? Wise child? Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? You are a very knowledgeable person. Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. The wisdom descendeth not from above, but it is earthly, sensual, and devilish. My dear brother, my dear sister, for where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. If you are a wise person, if you are endued with knowledge, don't give room for strife, chanda, quarrel. Don't give room for quarrel. Quarrel is the offshoot of bitterness, that hurt feeling. If you are a Christian, eschew that hurt feeling. Handle that bitterness. That bitterness will spoil your health. You'll have all kinds of sicknesses and diseases. Your blood pressure will shoot up. Your cholesterol. Your digestive system. You get peptic ulcer. All because of this bitterness. Your bones will lose marrow. That moisture in the bones will be lost. And tension will build up. All because of your harboring. That's a very simple thing, this bitterness. Bitterness may be the natural reaction of a hurt feeling. The very simple bitterness, as I told you, when your brother is banging his head against the door, if you are a person to say, venu, venu, you are a person who harbors bitterness. The bitterness is the root for everything. And in the book of Revelation, I don't have time to show you all the verses because I get four more points and we have got the Lord's Supper. In the book of Revelation chapter 8 verses 10 and 11, you read about a star called Wormwood. Wormwood means in Tamil, Yetti. You read about a star. Star speaks about servants of God, apostles, pastors, evangelists, prophets, a star. That star is full of bitterness. And when the star falls in any water body, river or sea or a pond, when that star called Wormwood falls in any water body, that makes that water body bitter. That makes that water body bitter. If a servant of God is full of bitterness, whatever the anointing he touches, whatever the heart of the people he touches, he would make everybody bitter. Their life would be bitter. Those who are sitting and talking to that person, it's contagious. He has got bitter feelings against somebody, and he touches you, you will become bitter. My dear brother, my dear sister, handle that bitterness. Take away that bitterness. God is over all. God is in full control. God knows what he should give for me, what he doesn't need to give for me. I won't have the nature of God. So unless you know to handle this bitterness, you cannot bless somebody who curses you. If this bitterness is taken away, they'll be going on cursing you and you'll be going on blessing them because that bitterness is not there. Is it practically possible? With all humility I tell you, it is possible. It's the grace of God. When you harbor bitterness, the Bible says you are falling short of the grace of God. Cling unto the grace of God. It's not that I am a goody-goody person. With all humility, God is a witness, and those who are close with me The senior believers here, they are a witness. Can anybody say that I got bitterness against anybody on the earth under the sky? I have faced problems. In the ministry I have faced problems. In the work spot I have faced problems. Maybe not very much. Maybe already we are lame. And we should allow that to be healed. We should not make the joints go out of their place. So do something that could be healed. That could be healed. Why do I say that I don't have bitterness against anybody? Just to make you understand that it's possible. That it's possible. So number one, handle your bitterness. Don't be bitter against anybody. You will be falling short of the grace and you will nondikala pesaka vachiruvinga. Ena alaga elichirukanga pattingala. Nondikala pesaka vachiruvinga. Number two, it's not only handling the bitterness. Number two, learn to forgive. If you want to bless somebody who has hurt you, like Jacob, somebody has taken away your blessings, your booty. Or like Hannah's, the other lady, somebody breaks your spirit. Or maybe a hard bondage like the Israelites. Something makes your life bitter. Learn to forgive. Not only remove the bitterness, again and again it will shoot up. Unless you know to forgive. I just show you only one verse for this. Mark chapter 11 verses 25 and 26. Only one reference. Mark chapter 11 verses 25 and 26. And when you stand praying, forgive. If you have aught against any. If you have got anything against anybody. When you stand and pray, forgive them. We are going to participate in the Lord's Supper. Anything against anybody. Somebody like Jacob has robbed your blessing. Somebody is going on teasing you. Somebody breaking your spirit. Whatever it may be. You may be right. They have spoken evil things against you. Like arrows, they are shooting words at you. Forgive them. So when you stand and pray, forgive. If you have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. As Father forgives your trespasses, you forgive them. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive your trespasses. So unless you forgive, you handle that bitterness, you cannot get God's forgiveness. You won't be a right person to receive that forgiveness. Because you don't have the nature to forgive. Now God's forgiveness cannot come upon you. It's a very simple scientific phenomenon. You don't have the nature to forgive, so you can't have forgiveness. You can't enjoy forgiveness. God cannot forgive. God wants to forgive you. There can't be a flow. His forgiveness cannot come in. I will explain it like this. Japta, come here for a minute. He has got a lot of hurt feelings. Just he doesn't have, but I'm telling you. Got a lot of hurt feelings within his heart. He cannot forgive. Now God wants to send his forgiveness. He cannot receive that forgiveness because it's full of hurt feelings. He cannot receive that forgiveness. Only when he removes that, only when he unties that cause of that bitterness, now he is able to receive forgiveness. He is able to receive forgiveness. So unless you empty yourself from hate feelings, you can never receive God's, thank you to me, you can never receive God's forgiveness. So you must know how to handle bitterness. When you handle bitterness, You must know to forgive them. Forgiveness is entirely a different teaching. I have spoken on forgiveness. I do believe that CD will be available at the VOC. It may be available at the YouTube, I don't know. Even otherwise, God willing, God leads, I'll speak to you on the topic forgiveness on a different account. Now, I don't want to go deep into it, but whatever the hurt feelings, you forgive them. How many times? 770 times a day. 490 times? If he does it for 491 times, not by the letter but by the Spirit. It doesn't mean that you have to count 1, 2, 3, 489, 490. No, no more, I will forgive you. No, it's not that Spirit. Any number of times. Empty it. You may be right. You have got a hurt feeling against somebody. Somebody has hurt you. Somebody has hurt you. Don't hold a revenge against them. That you are the loser. You are the loser. You are unable to receive God's blessings because you got something in your heart that God could not bless you. So let me go to the third one. So handle bitterness, forgive them, think on that is good. To bless them that curse you, let your mind, you are a person what you think. You are a person what you think. You think good, you are a good person. You think bad, you are a bad person. It is not what he says, who you are. I am a good person because my wife is good. I am a bad person because my wife is bad. You are not at all a person. Your very life is depending on others. You are good because he is good. I don't fight with my wife at all because my wife is very good. I don't fight with my husband because my husband is a very good person. What is that? I cannot bear that man. That's why always I fight. So you are not a person. If he is good, you are good. If he is bad, you are bad. Who are you then? Who are you then? I am good. That should not be depending upon somebody else. That should not be depending upon somebody else. You think what is good. You talk what is good. You do what is good. You be a good person. You be a Christian. You be a Christian depending upon somebody else is a mockery. I am a good Christian because everybody around me is good. My neighbor is good. My father is good. My wife is good. My daughter is good. My boss is good. My servant is good. Because everybody is good, I am good. When everybody is good, if you are a bad, you are not even a human being. What is the big thing that you are good and everybody around you is good? My neighbor is very good family. My boss, very good person. And my assistant, he'll be on time. He do everything perfectly all right. My wife, the best woman. Children, oh wonderful. I am a good man. I cannot tolerate because my neighbor is bad. Oh, I don't want to live with this woman. She is very bad. I can't work there because the boss is bad. There's one Pentecostalic man. He was a watchman, security watchman. He loved, adored, admired my father very much. Every day he would come and talk to my father and go. He's a Pentecostalic man, a Pentecostalic denomination that would say that we are the bride. We alone are the bride. That type of a Pentecostalic background. Every morning he would come and talk to my daddy. One day he was talking to my daddy I was sitting inside and I was listening to their conversation. This Pentecostalic man from a denomination that says we are bride of Christ, he was telling my daddy, ஐயா, நீங்கள் வேலையே பார்க்க முடியாதுயா, ஒருவே வேலை பார்க்க முடியாது, வேலையை விட்டுலான் இருக்கிறேன், மோசமான ஆட்கள் இல்லையா. மை ஃபாதர் வாஸ் லிஸ்னிங் பேஷண்ட்லி, ஆஸ்க்ட் ஹிம், ஹவு மெனி பீப்புள் ஆர் ஒர்க்கிங் தேர், ஹவு மெனி பீப்புள் ஆர் ஒர்க்கிங் தேர், 200 people. When 200 people can work there, why can't you work there? He put his head down. 200 people can work there, why can't you work there? Many a time we are ashamed to say that we are Christians. I can't live with this man. There are women who are living with drunkards, bad, wicked people, and you are a child of God. You say, no, I can't live with this man. Oh, I can't tolerate this woman. Because we don't see what is good around us. We don't see what is good around us. I got a lot of things to tell you. Just to give one illustration. One person with a lot of problem went to a servant of God. He said, all things are against me. I don't want to live this and that. Not one thing God has done for me. Immediately that pastor took a sheet of paper, put a line in the middle, gave to him. On the left hand side you write what all the evil you have faced. On the right what all the good the Lord has given you, you write on the right. He wrote, only the left he wrote. On the right side, there is nothing he has got to write. There is nothing he has, nothing good for him. Nothing good for him. So the pastor looked at him and said, when did your son come out of the prison? No, my son has never gone to any jail. He said, there's so many boys have gone to jail. Your son has never gone to jail. Is that good? He said, yes. Write it on the right hand side. My son has never gone to jail. Write it on the right hand side. He wrote it. I heard that your wife ran away with somebody. No. What do you say? There are so many wives, we read in the paper, they elope with somebody else, leaving their husband. Your wife has never left you. Is that not a good thing? He said, yes, write that. Write what all the good things you enjoy, what others don't enjoy in this world. What others don't enjoy in this world. Are you not enjoying that? Think what is good. You are unable to handle hurts because you think that is bad. You think what is wrong in your husband. You couldn't think what is right in your husband. You think what is wrong with your children. You could not think what is right with your children. You think what is wrong with your boss. You could not think what is right with your boss. Gunam nadi, kuttam nadi, avatul migai nadi, mikka kolal. Then you shall have peace that passeth all understanding. I just give you the reference to save time. Philippians chapter 4 verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things that are true, whatsoever things that are honest, whatsoever things that are just, whatsoever things that are pure, whatsoever things that are lovely, whatsoever things that are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Meditate on these things. Anything good in your house, think on that. Anything good, find out. Think on that. Your life would be blessed. And number three. So number one, handle bitterness. Know to forgive. Think positively or think on that is good. Think on that is good. You try to be a good person. And number four, it's very, very important. Increase your strength. Increase your strength. Okay, your enemy, somebody, he wants to destroy you. He wants to kill you. He does everything against you. When he died, or something bad happens to him, it's good or not, it's good. Your enemy is annihilated. Appa, problem is over. We are happy. Even we pray. You think that is advantageous for you. I tell you, what is greater advantageous? Not the annihilation of your enemy. Not the annihilation of your enemy. The greatest advantage, it may sound little politics, the greatest advantage when he becomes your friend. உங்க சத்துரு இல்லாமல் போவது உங்களுக்கு நன்மையானார். உங்க சத்துரு உங்க ஃப்ரெண்ட் ஆகிட்டா எவ்வளோ நன்மை? கொஞ்சம் யோசித்து பாருங்க. உங்க சத்துரு தொலைஞ்சிட்டாலே உங்களுக்கு நன்மை. அந்த சத்துரு உங்களுக்கு ஃப்ரெண்ட் ஆகிட்டானா எவ்வளோ நன்மை? Your strength will be increased. That's why we read in Proverbs 16:7, when a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. Your enemy will become your friend. That will be a greater strength. So don't increase your enemies. Don't make your wife your enemy. Don't make your children your enemy. Don't make your husband your enemy. Don't make your brothers your enemy. Whatever it may be, forgive them. Remove that bitterness. And try to let your ways be pleasing unto God. At one point or the other, they would become your, God will make them your friends. Probably you may have to lose a small property to win your enemy your friend. We buy a lot of things spending our money for our pleasure, am I right? By spending 50,000 rupees, you buy a TV. Lose 50,000 rupees to make your enemy your friend. It will be better than a TV. Your enemy becoming your friend, how much you spend for that? 50,000 rupees. Okay, that's a small thing. Now you've got one more friend. Your strength has increased. What's the cost? 50,000. Okay, let it go. Fighting for 50,000, you are increasing one more enemy in your life. You are keeping a thorn in your flesh. You are increasing your problem. It may sound little politics, but I tell you, it's a strength. And finally, when you know to bear loss to win him, rather bear loss, it is your expenditure. It is your investment. It is your investment, the project to win an enemy, make an enemy a friend. That's your project. That's your project. Let your relatives be your friends. There was a girl came with a problem. I told that girl, you're in that house, make everybody your relative. Don't say, unga mama vandha, unga chittappa vandhaaru, say, chinnamama vandhaaru. When that man comes in, go and tell your husband, unga chittappa vandhirukkaaru, welcome you, mama vanga, chittappa vanga, unga amma avde thambi vandhaaru. Chittappa vanga. When there is a problem, that chittappa will think this is my daughter. The chittappa will think this is my daughter. The chittappa will stand for your cause. He is my daughter. And many a time was the problem, we alienate everybody. Husband is wrong, wife is wrong, mama is wrong, atta is wrong, son is wrong, daughter is wrong, neighbor is wrong. There's nobody with you. You have made your life bitter. Finally, when you handle all four points, you will bless your enemy. When you bless your enemy, what happens? I read that passage and conclude. I want to say a lot of things and go back to Matthew chapter 5. Verse 44 I read. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Why? Verse 45, very important. That you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. You are not the child of the devil. That you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise upon the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. That's his nature. So you are doing good, whether that person is good or that person is not bad. Your nature has become good. You are not a dependent. You are not lame. You are not dependent. Your goodness doesn't depend on that person. Your goodness has become your nature. You are independent. You are independent of the other person. It's a very powerful one. May the Lord help you. Verse 46. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same? And if you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans do? It's a very simple arithmetic. You love them, you love them. What's the reward? They loved you, you loved. The transaction is over. They hated you, you hated them. The transaction is over. What is the big thing in it? He shouted at you, you shouted back. What's the big thing in it? Any ordinary person will do that. But you shower the rain whether he is good or bad. You do the good whether he is just or unjust. Whether your husband is right or wrong, you are right. Whether your wife is right or wrong, you are right. Whether your boss is right or wrong, you are right. Then you are the child of the Father in heaven. So verse 48 he says, be therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. What is this perfect already explained to you? Nothing more wanting. Nothing more wanting. Shall we just pray?